Hello and welcome back to the Scale Model Medic YouTube channel and part 3 of the budget Millennium Falcon series. At the end of the last video, I'd given the entire model a clear coat of Humbrol acrylic gloss. This was to be used as a base onto which to flow some oil washes to bring out the surface detail. I tested this on a small area of the model off camera and I was quite happy with the results, so at the beginning of this video I'm going to apply this technique to the entire Millennium Falcon model. In keeping with the budget theme, I'm going to be using old school oil washes using lamp black, burnt umber and titanium white to achieve the effect that I desire, and to dilute the washes I'm going to be using Humbrol enamel thinners which I know and trust. As well as the oil washes, I've also got some of these enamel based weathering products from Mig Ammo. I don't want to throw too many expensive products at this model as it is a budget modelling series, but I might use these later if I need a bit of extra variety in the wash colours. I've also got some similar products from AK Interactive that I'll keep on standby. Again, I'll only use them in very limited amounts if at all, and it'll only be to add some variety to the washes. Because the Millennium Falcon is such a beat up and dirty vehicle, I want these washes to be the first stage in the weathering process as well as enhancing the surface detail of the model. Instead of mixing up a straight dark grey wash to replicate shadows in the recessed areas, I'm going to mix in some of the burnt umber oil paint to round the grey off into a much grimier shade. This will replicate built up dirt and debris in all the nooks and crannies on the surface, and I'll use this wash over the majority of the model. This is the first step in the weathering process that I intend to carry out, and it's a big model, so I'm going to mix up quite a lot of this wash. The gloss varnish that I applied at the end of the last video will help create capillary action, which is what's drawing the wash into all of those areas of detail. You can see that I only need to touch the brush onto the surface, and the dark brown mixture will flow around, meaning that there's minimum work to do, there's just a lot of surface area to cover. Filming the application of this much oil paint to a model this size would have been really quite tedious, so instead what I'm going to do is a quick visual comparison of how the model looked before the washes were applied and how it looks afterwards to see how much of a difference this technique has made. Even though I applied the oil paint very carefully, there are still some areas that need cleaning up, so I'm going to use a brush and a cotton bud soaked in enamel thinners to tidy up after myself. All I need to do is carefully skirt over the model and pick off any oils that I'm not happy with. It is worth noting that this sort of technique can wear the model through to the bare plastic, so I'm going to move quickly and not build up too much thinners in one area. When I'm finished, I should be left with washes only where I want them, and then I can move on to the next step. And here's how it looks when I'm finished with it. The washes are all in. All of the surface detail has been enhanced, and it's time to move on now and start to really weather this surface. Before I can continue, however, I need to get rid of the glossy finish left behind by the Humbrol Clear. To do this, I'm going to airbrush the model using matte varnish from Mig Ammo. The Mig Ammo matte varnish is going to be applied using my Infinity 2-in-1 airbrush from Harder and Steenbeck, and it can be sprayed straight from the bottle in nice light coats to kill off any of the shine. The reason that I'm seeking a matte finish instead of a gloss one is because from now on I don't want any of the oil paints to flow, instead I want to be able to grind them into the surface to discolour the paint underneath. This is basically allowing me to get even more use out of the oil paints later on by changing the way they behave on the surface of the model. I'm also using the matte varnish as a sealant to protect those washes. I'm quite happy with how they look, so I don't want any further enamel thinners to affect them when I apply it to the surface of the model. Here you can see a small corner of the Falcon that's been treated with the matte and how it's taken away the shine. By checking my reference pictures of the big Falcon from the movie, I've spotted some areas of intense rusty brown colour around the engines of the Falcon. Because I've already used the burnt umber oil paint, this tone exists on the model, so to add some variety, I'm going to crack open the Mig Ammo starter set for US Green Tanks, as it contains an interesting reddy brown wash that I think might add the variety I need. The exact shade that I'm going to try out is the dark brown wash for green vehicles. Obviously this isn't a green vehicle, but it certainly adds a different colour to the burnt umber. I'm also going to be using the AK Interactive Streaking Grime for dark yellow vehicles. The Mig Ammo wash is quite intense, so I'm going to add a touch of Humbrol's enamel thinners just to tone it down a bit, and then I'm going to apply some quite localised patches of this colour where the reference pictures show me that there are some rusty areas. I was quite impressed with this stuff when I applied it. Even though I'd thinned it down, it did really affect the colours underneath, so it's clearly got a lot of pigment in it, and it will have uses in future when I'm doing more armour modelling. I also added some of this colour to different areas of the Falcon, just so that in future as I move on with the weathering, I've got more than just my limited palette of oils and the surface is broken up a little bit. Perhaps not surprisingly, the AK Interactive product was very similar to the MIG one. It was very intense straight from the bottle and benefited from some additional thinners to help tone the colour down and to help it flow. You can see how much it soaks into the surface when you compare it to how the washes went on over the gloss finish, and I used this around various points on the model and varied the intensity to build up some localised areas of interest. It's also worth pointing out that although MIG himself and AK Interactive don't always see eye to eye, their products don't seem to have any trouble getting along, and you can mix and match the two to build up various different colours. Here I'm using the AK Interactive wash to enhance the areas where I applied the MIG Ammo washes earlier on, and again it adds yet another dimension to the weathering and builds up some areas where things would have looked a bit ordinary had I kept it to just the limited oil palette that I've got at my disposal. Instead of just cleaning the excess away like I did with the oil washes, because I've got a matte surface, I can bring those effects outwards and allow them to seep into the matte surface of the model. Here I'm using a flat brush which has been soaked in enamel thinners to spread those colours around. It's time to get back to the oil paint weathering now, and rather than using any enamel thinners, I'm going to be mixing up my weathering colours neat and then adding thinners later on. By varying the amounts of black, white and brown, I've mixed up four main shades which I'll use all over. These can be varied by adding more white or brown on the surface of the model, and these will be a good starting point. The next step is to simply dot some of that neat oil paint here and there on the different panels, focusing the darker colours in areas where there would be natural shade, and the lighter colours around the central areas, such as on the edge of these middle panels here. With the oils applied, it's time to blend them all together and bring this technique to fruition. To do this, I'm going to apply enamel thinners to a brush and then wick it all away using a tissue until there's hardly anything left. This will be stamped into the surface using a vertical motion to blend the oils together. That matte varnish will cling onto the colour and it will basically work like a large palette, allowing me to mix the colours actually in situ and then wipe away any excess using the tissue until I'm happy with the finish. It can be quite nerve-wracking undertaking a drastic technique like this on a model which has taken so long to paint, but remember it's oils which take ages to dry, so if anything goes wrong you can always crack out the cotton buds and thinners and wipe it all away. Here I'm blending in that solid white until only the corner of the panel is highlighted, and any of the excess which spreads too far can simply be wiped away using the clean brush. Continuous blending of the oil paint removes a small amount each time the brush is cleaned, so even if the effect seems a bit too harsh at first, it will tone down over a small amount of working and you have complete control over the finished effect. By working on one small area at a time and cleaning the brush in between areas, I can retain all of the different tones that I mixed in with the oil paints rather than blending everything together into one nondescript colour. Here I'm using some of the very dark shades to add an area of very high contrast in a small recessed part of the Falcon round by some pipe detailing. This looks very strong to begin with, but like I mentioned earlier, this technique does give you complete control. So as you'll see over the following footage, I gradually remove the oil paint by working it with the brush and eventually the effect is reduced to a point where I think it doesn't stand out too much, but it still adds something to the overall finish. As I've mentioned previously, the colour palette that I'm using is very limited, so I'm mixing in some pure white and pure black with the oils as I go along, just to vary the tones a little bit. Here I'm using pure white along the edges to give a bit of shading as well as weathering to the surface of these panels. I'm going to use the last of these oil paints now to carry out some streaking. All I'm doing is taking a very small amount of the darker shade of oil and dragging it vertically down the surface of the model to create a streak. This is a key part of the final look of the Millennium Falcon, as those reference pictures that I was looking at earlier shows that this technique was used all over the original prop. It appears from the pictures that they used some kind of powder or pastel in the original model, but I prefer to use oils because, as with the earlier techniques, it gives me complete control over the final effect. If anything doesn't look right, I can simply work it away with thinners until it looks how I want or it's removed completely. Another benefit to using oil paints in this fashion is the strength of colour. As you can see, just a few passes of the brush is enough to build up quite a bold effect, and that means I can work quickly, which is really handy for a model of this size. If I'd had to use multiple layers of ultrafine weathering, this model would have taken me even longer than it already has. I need big results in as very little time as possible if I'm going to have any chance of finishing this piece. The same kind of techniques can now be worked across the entire surface of the model to add contrast, shadow and tone. I'll keep repeating these same techniques over and over until I'm happy with the way it's looking. Here I'm using a very localized application of oils and blending it together with a soft brush just to break up a few of the panels which look a bit monotone. Speaking of breaking up the panels, if we take another look at the reference pictures, you can see that the whole Falcon is covered in small amounts of battle damage after Han and Chewie have had a run-in with a few Imperial forces. I'm going to use a bit of neat black oil paint to replicate this battle damage in the simplest way possible. A small amount of the black is dabbed onto the surface in the same location as it's shown on the reference pictures, and then I'm going to use a nice soft brush to simply streak the oil paints, as I've done with all the other techniques so far. Using a small amount of the black oil on a small brush, I'm then going to fill out the blast mark a little bit to give it a more rounded appearance. You may also notice that these streaks don't follow the same direction as the weathering techniques, but that's the way the reference pictures show them, so I've copied it as best I can. To finish the blast marks off, a little bit of Mig Ammo Satin Black was touched into the centre of the weathered area using a fine brush just to enhance the contrast. And here we can see the culmination of all those weathering techniques and just how much of a difference they've made to the way the model looks. I think you'll agree that this is starting to become a much more respectable replica of the Millennium Falcon. I deliberately chose to use oil paints for this model because they're cheap and this is a budget modelling series, but also because I think that these antique materials have been overshadowed by more modern releases, but they've still got a place on any modeller's workbench thanks to the fact that they're versatile and that they give great results. In the next video, hopefully I'll be finishing the Falcon off with a final layer of weathering and trying to match it more closely to the original movie prop. There's just time left now to have a quick before and after comparison at what a difference the weathering techniques have made. Here's the before pictures and here's the afterwards. I think you'll agree that for a few pounds on oil paints, that's a hell of a difference to make. Thanks very much for watching and I'll see you again next time.